this morning by singing The Power of the Cross. If you would stand with me, please.
You got one of the communion containers when you walked in. If you didn't, if you'll raise your hand, we can get one to you. Did everybody get one? It looks like Miss Betty, you did not get one. Could we? There we go. Thank you, Miss Sandra. All right. So, and I'll just let you know, I have pre-done mine today, the talk. And so the same thing that happened. If the Christmas Eve service is not going to happen tonight, so this morning, rather. So I thank you for putting up with these. We're grateful. And remember, it is the symbol of what we're doing as well. So you remember that And we just took communion, like I said, on Christmas Eve. But it's a great time to reflect on why we're here as believers, why we're here as a church, a commitment to 2021 as well, and looking at, as a follower of Jesus Christ, basically 5 times a year, we set aside some time to remember specifically the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus. And we do that by just using something very common, a wafer and grape juice, to do that. And you know that that night, he took that bread, and when he took that bread, he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. And so if you will take that, and it is a reminder of what the Lord did, what he endured on the cross, shedding his blood on our behalf. We also know that they passed out the wine that night, he wanted them to drink that as a remembrance of his shedding of his blood as well. So let's do that now. And you know, there will come a time, and I can tell you right now, I miss coming to the altar to do that. I miss that. And I'm hoping at some point, excuse me, during 2021, sooner rather than later, we will get to do that. We're just continuing to try to be cautious with that. And maybe by the time all the vaccines get out and it warms up, maybe we can see that. What do you think, Bubba?
Yes, as good as mine.
And there you go. Yeah, that's our pharmacist saying that. So anyway, why don't we pray together and we'll continue our song service. Father, we do thank you for just that symbol of remembrance. The scripture says that the Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. So the thought of the Lord Jesus being crucified, shedding his blood on that cross, it was not some mere afterthought. In eternity past, that was decided. It was decided to win your people. And as human beings, we struggle with the thought of eternity past and eternity future. But Lord, when we look and we see that wafer and that grape juice, we can remember what our redemption cost. It cost your blood. It cost your body. And we are grateful for that. Let us live in remembrance of that as though we were taking communion every day. Because in effect, every time we open the Word of God, every time we pray, we're being reminded of the sacrifice that Jesus made to give us the ability to enter the throne room of grace. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning is How Firm a Foundation. Stand with me, please.
Thank you.
learned my lesson last week, although it gave a little bit of fun to the sermon when I almost tripped over the altar there, but I watched today. You know, this is a great time. 2021 is really a good time to remember as we routinely think about goals for a new year. And it could be a checkup. It could be a physical checkup. It could be a spiritual checkup. It might be that you think about maybe not eating as much, not drinking as much, maybe exercising more, maybe how to save a little bit more money, how to make more money, maybe give a little bit more money to what you believe in. You know, maybe you decide that you're going to try to read a little bit more this year. I don't know. Maybe you're going to try to spend a little less time on social media. I highly recommend that, by the way. Another thought there, but maybe you're going to spend less time playing video games. All these things are good things. They're good things to do. I know as well for sure that if you've decided that there's an area of your life that you are dissatisfied in, that, you know, if I'm dissatisfied about my cardiovascular health, you know, me just sitting and thinking about my cardiovascular health, is that going to do anything? No, it's not going to do anything. I mean, I'm going to have to get out and walk or jog or, for heaven's sake, run, which I don't like that at all. You know, my son puts me to shame because he not only runs, he wears a rucksack. If you're familiar with a rucksack, that's where you put a 20 to 40 pound weight in a backpack and run with it. Insanity, in my opinion. But both my sons do it. Bless their hearts. They even do push-ups with them. You know, and it just makes me tired thinking about it. However, you know, it's like, it's the old saying that the man who aims at nothing hits it every time. So if I'm dissatisfied about some component in my life, then I've got to make sure that I'm going to do something about it. And when you're examining a healthy lifestyle for yourself, whether it be, like I said, aerobic kind of activity, cardiovascular activity, general calisthenics, all those things can help you with flexibility. Using light weights can help strengthen your muscles and tendons and overall bone structures. So, you know, it's really important for you and for me if we're wanting to do something about those areas of our lives to get busy and do those things. Again, I don't particularly care for any of those things. But if I'm dissatisfied in that arena, then I've got to make sure that I do that. I can tell you this. It would be wise for some of us to have a checkup with a doctor before we start on something like that. Amen? You know, and that would be true. I can't say it would be true for you, but, you know, it would be important for you if you're going to do some rigorous exercise and you haven't done that in a few years, probably ought to get checked out before you decide to do that. But imagine this for just a moment. Imagine that you scheduled to have this checkup done. It's a good thing. They send you a text to say, hey, you've got an appointment on Thursday at 9:00. And so they send you that on Monday, so you respond. And, you know, I got a text message, an email, and a phone reminder about this from the same office about this one appointment. You know, they want to make sure I'm coming. So I confirm that. And you would confirm that as well. Then imagine you know, it's one of these checkups where you don't eat anything. And I hate those, by the way. And I'm not the only one. I know you are as well, that you got to fast before you have this checkup. You know, so the only thing, I mean, I did drink black coffee. I've been told that that's okay. So I drink some coffee, or you could drink some coffee, and so you wind up going to the facility, and all of a sudden, the very first thing out of the mouth from this person is a list of different COVID symptoms. Thank you. Somebody said, it was you. Thank you. coping systems. And so and this happened to me. I was trying to keep it third person, but it's too obvious, right? So they start asking about coping systems, and one of them was a headache. And I said, well, yeah, I got a headache. I fasted. I hadn't eaten anything. I'm really hungry. And so I know I've got a headache. And they said, well, have you been coughing at all? Y'all know me, right? You think I had been coughing at all? Yeah. And I said, well, my normal routine of coughing is, I just sort of have those two things and nothing else. My temperature is 95.9 when they take it, which is about what it is here when Robin or somebody takes it. I go sit down and I'm reading just a great book, and I got there early, very quiet. The waiting room was pretty empty, and they called me over there, and they said, Mr. Johnson, the provider thinks you have the start of COVID and wants you to reschedule. And of course, what's running through my mind is, if I am sick, and COVID is as bad as it is for people that are, in the 60s, 70s, 80s, why are they sending me home? I look at them and said, look, I just go somewhere else, don't worry about it. But I just thought, how crazy is that they would do that? Now, I understand not wanting to spread it in the doctors. I get that. I really do. I just sort of pulled back from it a little bit, and it just really befuddled me that this office said that. Well, I mean, what if they sent me home and I had some crazy, inability to breathe and died there at my house after being turned away? All those things were run through my mind of, the very place that was the best place for a sick person to be was where? At the doctor's office. Or the hospital. I mean, either way. But it just didn't make any sense to me. Well, can I sort of take that and tweak it just for a minute, and let's talk about And that really did happen, and I know as they said that, I was looking at them like, are you kidding me? I mean, I just really was, because I felt completely fine and stuff. They basically were telling me, oh, there's nothing to worry about, you're fine, but if that was as bad as it was, and they just turned me away, was that the right thing to do? Can I ask you a question? When we have people come into this facility, if we don't warn them, if we don't tell them, it's a whole lot worse than me getting COVID. Amen? You see, the very thing that the doctor's office is designed to do, which is to treat sick people, the local church was not designed to be a meeting place. It was designed to help sick, hurting, broken people. We've turned churches into places just where people gather, and sick people and hurting people, when they come to those places, don't feel like they're welcome. When people that are desperately wicked come, do we just turn them away and tell them, can we talk? I'm a little embarrassed with you being here. Maybe can we visit on Tuesday?
No.
Thank you, John. Amen, John. I listen. Listen, brother, you are a lot more right than you realize there. You really are. We, as a church, we have basically a function of three things. First and foremost, as we gather, we are gathered to worship and glorify our sovereign King, Jesus. Amen. That's it. As an act of that worship, we are to evangelize and we are to disciple. Outside of those three things, and you understand, if we miss those three things, we have no reason to exist. Amen? I'm being as serious as I can be. If we miss those, we're just like that doctor's office. Now, did that doctor's office hate me? No, they didn't hate me. And did they want me to be sick and go away and stuff? No, that's not true either. They want me to be well, but they just didn't want to do it then. But their mission doesn't change. So if we can say for a body that me doing jumping jacks or push-ups or pull-ups or running and getting ready for a 3K or a 5K, or for me would be a half K, you know, it really would. But if those things are good, and I can point at, you know, my I can tell you normally my blood pressure runs 125-ish to 75 to 80. That's pretty good. You know, my pulse runs in the 70 range. Again, that's pretty good. You know, my cholesterol is normally okay. It can sort of vary a little bit, but nothing out of range. My oxygen levels are always in the 95% range. You know, those are indicators of a generally healthy person. Now, there could be some other things there. I mean, I don't mind telling you that about me. It's not that big a deal. But what about if we talked about some indicators of health in a church? And there are some general indicators in churches that reveal health. For the next couple of Sundays, we're going to look at a few of those. We won't look at a bunch of them. But let's just talk about that for a minute. And I realize this is very different than what we normally do. Here's some things that you might want to know about what's happening with churches generally today. Estimates are that in 2020, there were as many as 10,000 churches that closed. That's a lot. In a given year, normally you could look at maybe 5,000 to 7,000, but COVID sort of hit in different places a little bit harder. Estimates are that church attendance will be 20 to 30% less than the pre-COVID attendance. Ours is more than that. We've got people that haven't come back since then, for whatever the reason is. Look, and if there are people out there that are still afraid of getting COVID, you stay home and make sure you're comfortable with coming before you come. Amen. I've said that all through. But there'll come a time where hopefully we'll get past that. When is that going to be? I mean, Bubba, our pharmacist, sort of shrugged and acted like, I don't know. He doesn't know. I don't know either. Jesus knows, and that's about it. Estimates are as well that giving will be down 20 to 30% in churches as well. And that makes sense if attendance is down. And churches right now across this country, depending on the state that they are in a state of uncertainty, not knowing what the economy is going to have, not knowing about this vaccine, whether people are going to take it, not take it, whether it's going to work or not. And you know, I've got a friend that I occasionally will communicate with back and forth. He's a doctor in Indiana. He has done a vaccine zombie watch. He's a medical doctor. And so every now and then he'll say, I took the COVID vaccine 8 hours ago. So far, I'm not a zombie. And he's continued to do that. And it's been almost a week now since he's had it. He's been fine. There are some people that have experienced a few symptoms from taking it. Were they related to the vaccine? I don't know. You know, I would never tell you to not take it or to take it. You've got to make that decision with a doctor, a medical person. However, in the face of this uncertainty, can I make a comment to you that COVID-19 has not surprised God at all? Amen? It's not surprised him at all. And, you know, while some people might think that it's a terrible time to be a pastor of a church, I think it's the perfect time. I think it's the perfect time. It is the perfect time for us to examine why we exist and to make sure that going forward, we are doing what God has called us to do, as this church has done for decades. Amen? Does that mean we need to think a little harder about how active we are in evangelism and discipleship? I think we do. I really think we do. We've got to be willing to look and see if our blood pressure isn't 120 over 80, why is that? If our pulse isn't a certain pulse, or if we've got a little bit too much cholesterol in the system, what is it that's going to help with that? I can tell you what helps with all those things is activity, but not activity just to have activity. It is a perfect time for us to make sure that we know what indicators of a healthy church are. And while we can point to a number of things, I want to point to just one today. And we'll look at a couple, maybe two or three a week for the next couple of weeks, and then we'll move on from that. But we've got to make sure, for sure, as we look at indicators, and I believe that the church already is here, but making sure that we establish the supremacy of God's Word as the foundation and the focus of everything that we do. Amen? Amen? We've got to make sure of that. We've got to make sure of that corporately. We've got to make sure of that individually. We've got to make sure of that. And in doing this, we've got to make sure that God's Word isn't taught haphazardly. And how is it that God is going to be most glorified and the church is going to be most edified? And I can tell you the answer to that question. The teaching that does that is the one that exposes God's Word to God's people. Period. It's not my opinion. My opinion is irrelevant. You don't want my opinion. You want what the Bible says. Amen?
Amen?
The moment I start giving you my opinion, you need to fire me. When I'm standing right here, what matters is this book. And my task during the week is to get into this book and to be able to teach it authoritatively to you. That's why I'm here. If I do anything short of that, I'm not doing what I believe God's called me to do. So let's look at the first indicator. The first indicator of a generally healthy church is, now, and by the way, I think in your notes I put on there that there's a lot of content in there. I'm looking at two or three different sources, but one of the sources for sure is from a guy named Mark Dever. So just be aware of that. The first indicator, the first mark is what he called is expositional preaching. Expositional preaching. And it winds up being the foundation for everything else that follows. And if a church misses this one, it's likely the others won't follow. You might say, well, what is that? What does that mean, expositional preaching? It's in contrast to a lot of other styles that are out there. Let me just say this. Let's just say that I decide what I want to preach on a given Sunday. And then I run out and go find a Bible passage that backs that up. That's not expositional preaching. That's me finding my opinion in the text that I want to make sure that y'all hear on a given Sunday. Can that be a good sermon? Yeah. I'm not saying a pastor can't do that. But if that happens week after week after week after week, what that is called is a thing called topical preaching. Now, is that awful and terrible? I'm not saying that at all. But what tends to happen when a pastor focuses on topical preaching is that he tends to hit what he's interested in all the time rather than letting the text determine what he's preaching. Now, I'll be honest with you, that's one reason why I enjoy preaching through books. Because that, you know, there are some texts I would rather not preach. But if it's in the book, I'm going to preach it. Because look, do we believe as a church that this is God's word? From Genesis to Revelation. Do we? Cover to cover. Even where it says genuine or invitation letter. Okay. Yeah. If that's true, and we call that the whole counsel of God, then we've got to be willing to look at it in the light of what the Scripture says. So that when you begin, you don't jump over something because it's a little bit harder. The message in expositional preaching finds its sole source in Scripture, and the message isn't extracted from two or three verses, possibly, or more. You could do more than that. But this message, according to John MacArthur, it correctly interprets Scripture in its normal sense and in its context. You might wonder why occasionally we'll talk about Greece, we'll talk about Rome, we'll talk about some other country during that time. It's because that was the context in which those authors spoke. And then we take that idea of what it was then, and then we look at it in our context today. But can I tell you this? That what it meant 2,000 years ago is what it means today. You know, it's sort of equivalent to the way that some people look at the Constitution. You know, you've heard people say we need constitutionalists on the Supreme Court. I agree with that. We need the founders' opinion being taught, being studied, and then being practiced across the country. But you don't have that. What you have are, in many places, are judges who believe that the Constitution is a living document that can be changed basically by anything that they want to do. You do understand that's exactly what's happening with Scripture in a lot of churches. And in doing that, they're making things that we would say aren't appropriate okay today. You know, I mean, I could just bring up one example. I could bring up one example. If you look at abortion, or you look at homosexual marriage, two very dominant themes in our political life today, right? I mean, we hear about it a pretty good bit. I've mentioned to you before, I mean, if someone who had an abortion were to come through those doors, what would they find at Emory? I hope they'd find love here. To be honest with you, that's what I hope they'd find. Would they find forgiveness here, or would they find judgment? Now, granted, I believe they are going to be judged for that, unless they've been forgiven for that. But when they walk through those doors, they've got to know that we stand for something, but we love them anyway. Amen? We love them. Now, if I just did a message on abortion outside of the context, and again, I'm not telling you that a topical sermon's a bad thing. I'm just saying it's different. But when we hit passages on marriage, on family, on children, in a text, we're able to deal with those things. Expository preaching will tend to present itself through books, verse by verse, letting Scripture be the better interpreter than cultural norms. And if Scripture is inerrant and infallible, then we should treat it in such a fashion. And here's the other thing I think is important as well. And remember, this is an indicator, in my opinion, of that, is that the message has got to be more important than the messenger. It's got to be more important than the messenger. So consequently, when the message is preached, it is preached authoritatively, it shapes us, it challenges us, and a healthy church is one that once it has been challenged, that hears the word of God, it begins to be shaped and moved in that fashion. A healthy church as well is composed of individual Christians who hear the word of God and who are shaped by the word of God, and then who commit to live the word of God day by day. So one reason why Explorers is very important. You know, it's one reason why Sunday school is important. Right now we're looking in 2 Peter, and it's a great book that we're doing that. But at the end of the day, you and I, and you might think, well, you're not preaching to yourself. Are you kidding me? But when your father was studying, was he preaching to himself to get into the pulpit? Oh my goodness. I can tell you there are days when I open the text and I just think, God, I can't do this. Because this is just ripping me up. And he's called me to expose, that's the word exposition, to expose God's word to you Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. And not draw attention to myself, but draw attention to Him. A healthy church, that first indicator is that the message is about Him and not the messenger. Now, next week we will look at the second mark. And the second mark, you'll have to find out by coming. All right? Why don't we pray together? Father, we do thank you for this day that you have given us. Lord, and I know this church has stood on the word of God for decades. And I'm so thankful that is not a battle that has not had to be fought. Leon Burton believed it. He taught it, and I'm grateful for that. And very other able men have stood in that pulpit. Frank Conway, Frank Burton, and many others have stood there before me and expounded the Word of God. And I'm thankful for that. So, Father, as we look at just these healthy indicators in a local church, I pray that we examine ourselves and to see where is it that we can be at the end of 2021? And what does that look like? What are the goals that we would set for ourselves as a church? Lord, I know that some people think that setting a goal like that just means we want to get a lot bigger and huge. Lord, I just want us to be as faithful as you've called us to be. And we'll leave everything else up to you. You just called us to be good stewards of the Word of God, good stewards of our finances, to be good stewards, to be good ministers to one another and to others. And I just pray that we'll be faithful in those endeavors. We will be faithful to see people that are hurting, that are outside the gospel. We'll see people that are very young in the gospel and they need nurturing. We'll see other believers who have departed from the path, and we would love them enough to sit with them and urge them to come back to the faith. Let us just be faithful. Just use us to make a difference, not just at 872 Watson Road, but wherever we are, whether we're in college or high school or in a job or we're retired, wherever it might be, on vacation, just use us. And let us be faithful to your call. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Excuse me. Let me go, Lord, in prayer. Bill Burton, would you mind coming to this microphone and closing us in prayer? Would you mind doing that, sir?
Dear Lord, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come into your house and give honor and praise and glory up into your name, dear Lord.
Yes.
We are so thankful for the ones that could be here, dear Lord. We ask that you continue your watch care upon those who could not be here with us this morning and those who chose not to be with us this morning. We do not judge, dear Lord, not in this time. And we just ask you to continue to bless each and every one of us as we go throughout our days, dear Lord, and during these trying times. Continue your watch care upon each and every one of us until we can once again all be back together again in your presence, dear Lord. We offer up our praise to you. And go with us now throughout the rest of this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, sir. You're dismissed.